Well, I think my personal advice to younger people is to, for them to work professionally and to love the environment and love each other.
You're here to speak at the EcoCity Summit today.
Yes.
And can I ask why you feel that this summit is a significant platform to speak about Indonesia's efforts in combating climate change?
Because Indonesia is very concerned with the welfare of the cities and regions. So it is very opportune that we talk about that, and it can be also displayed to the world what we're doing. So it is I'm very happy to speak here about that.
Can you maybe share with us a bit, like, how do you see cities take up the challenge of mitigating climate change or adapting to climate change?
Well, according to the stipulations of the Conference of Parties, in particular the Paris Agreement, cities is a source of pollution. So if we can overcome pollution in the cities, then we're almost halfway there. A large percentage of the pollution in the cities contribute to the world pollution, and that's where people stay. So that is easier to overcome rather than outside of the cities, where forest fires and other natural disasters cannot be mitigated because there's nobody there. So city and Indonesia is endangered by having a large urbanization. We have a lot of cities. We have to date around 500 small towns, around 20 metropolitans, and it is very important that we learn from other countries to overcome the problems of cities.
I heard some people argue that Indonesia, for example, we as a developing nation must first concentrate on providing basic services for the population. So we are so lagging behind that it makes no sense to sort of shift our attention to fighting climate change. And what would you say to that?
Well, I think, of course, it's very important that we take care of the alleviation of poverty.
Yeah.
That is of prime importance everywhere, because we cannot save the trees and ignore the livelihood of people. But that comes second, right? The climate change is second to the well-being of the country. And that speaks for Indonesia, because adaptation programs in Indonesia are very important. But we find out, where science teaches us, that mitigation actions are as well as adaptation and mitigation are all the same coin. So if we adapt well, then we mitigate well, because populations, they pollute if they are not they don't live well. So we have to have the proper infrastructure, proper housing, proper everything, and that will save the climate as well.
So
there's no controversy between adaptation and mitigation.
So they can work together.
Yeah, they should work together.
Achieve both goals
right
at the same time, I suppose.
Yes.
Yeah. So, and in that sense, can you perhaps describe to us some of the core policy frameworks recently that has been put in place, let's say, to streamline that national target or global target with the local or subnational commitments in Indonesia?
Yes, I think that's a very proper question, because sometimes central planning does not coincide with the local needs. So we try to jam them together, and we have the Central Planning Board, which is the what we call the Bappenas in Indonesia, that tries to work from the bottom up and to concrete into a central planning. We have plans, a midterm plan, long-term plan, and I think everybody can work together in that. If it is ignored, then we are not an autocratic society, we are a democratic society. Everybody is free to speak out, but they have to follow the planning that is agreed by everyone. So.
Yes.
But we have learned not to ignore the traditional wisdom, that Indonesia has a store of traditional wisdom.
Yeah.
Even climate change efforts can be rolled back into the private or the local wisdom that is very present in Indonesia.
Can you perhaps talk a bit more on the potential for upscaling this kind of city-wide initiative? Like, let's say Surabaya now, we have some best practices.
Mm-hmm.
But how do we upscale it to a larger, like, national rollout?
I think the key to that is the empowering of the people, and that means education.
Yep.
If we can educate, in particular the younger generation, mm-hmm. to love the environment and to be aware, mm-hmm. of the dangers of ignorance, then we can start from there, because our populations, like I mentioned, was in the once in the millions.
Yeah.
You cannot order them around, so they have to be with them together.
Yeah. And I guess in the context of that, leveraging regional or bilateral partnerships with Australia,
yes.
One of our closest neighbors here in Asia Pacific, I guess, what is your perspective on some of the more fruitful ways we can engage with, yeah. each other?
Well, Indonesia and Australia has a very historical alliance. I mean, mm-hmm. working together since our independence, in fact.
Yes.
And in particular in the COP13, where Australia, under the leadership of Kevin Rudd, mm-hmm. has been giving us a very positive push towards the success of COP13.
Yes.
And it continues until today.
Mm-hmm.
And we try to learn from what Australia has been doing right and wrong, because mm. you are still exploiting the fossil fuel things.
Yes.
But in Perth, I understand the solar energy
uh-huh.
is being developed, which I would like to learn from that, because we try to get to have the best of the alternative energy,
mm.
in particular of the energies that is hardly available in Indonesia.
So in technology. Yeah.
So we want to learn and to exchange information about the,
yes.
best practices that is now I witness in Australia.
Yes.
Like the discipline of the people, not of the mm. people. We have to discipline ourselves.
Mm.
And certainly the exploitation of the nature's resources, which mm. for Indonesia, there's still a lot of as abundant.
Mm-hmm.
The geothermal, the solar, and the biomass, and the everything.
So yes.
We will work together, and I think we will work together